This morning's reading is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, and reading from verses 1 to 22. The priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed. So the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas the high priest was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them, and began to question them. By what power or name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame, and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. When they saw the courage of Peter and John, and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing there with them, there was nothing they could say. So they ordered them to withdraw from the Sanhedrin and then conferred together. What are we going to do with these men? They asked. Everyone living in Jerusalem knows they have performed a notable sign, and we cannot deny it. But to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, we must warn them to speak no longer to anyone in this name. Then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, Which is right in God's eyes? To listen to you or to him? You be the judges. As for us, we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard. After further threats, they let them go. They couldn't decide how to punish them because all the people were praising God for what had happened. For the man who was miraculously healed was over 40 years old. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks, Alan, for reading that for us. Peter and John, in front of the religious leaders, having that talk, having that debate. I wanted to call this Peter's conflict with the religious leaders and how he dealt with it. And let me share a few bits that I thought would be good. So as we carry on looking at this book of Acts, and we've seen fledgling congregation in Jerusalem experience tremendous gain. We've seen them grow. The Holy Spirit descended upon them. As a result, we see more than 3,000 people or souls were baptized into the membership of their church. And last week, we saw how God miraculously saves and heals this man, this crippled man who can walk for more than 40 years. So what can we get out of this chapter, these verses that we read about Peter's, this conversation with the Sanhedrin? I have divided this chapter or these verses into three different parts I'm going to share with you this morning. The first thing is we will see who these religious leaders are. The second one is we'll see what the question that they are asking. And finally, the most important bit is how Peter actually answers their question. So these guys, who are they? Verse 1 says, the priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John and while they were speaking to the people. So who are these Sadducees? What we know about them, first, is they only accept the first five books of the Old Testament as being authoritative. They believe the rest of the Old Testament to be a commentary on the Pentateuch. Because of their incomplete view of the Old Testament, they didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead, because the idea is not mentioned in the first five books of the Bible. So they're just a couple. They wasn't just a couple of temple employees, but we have three different groups of mentioned here. The first were called priests. But in verse 2, it says they were greatly annoyed. Just annoyed. They were greatly annoyed. Why were they greatly annoyed? First of all, because this teaching that was happening in the temple, they didn't have, Peter and John didn't have the credentials to do it. So they were annoyed at them, saying, how can you do this? Who's given you the authority? And these guys were talking about Jesus and his resurrection, so that annoyed them more. So what did they do with them? Verse 3 and 4 tells us. Basically, they arrested them, and they put them in custody until the next day, for it was evening. But even in that midst, so many who had heard the word believed. And the word says, our number of people was saved. That's what's happening here. Peter and John were arrested, but through that, God still did something amazing. These early convicts, I don't want to call them convicts because they won't be. These early converts believed the gospel. And they believed the truth about resurrection of Jesus. Even in the arrest of the apostles happening right before their eyes. They asked John and Peter a question. That's my second point. And their question has got nothing to do with this healing that's just happened. They wanted to ask a question. In verse 3, they say, they seized Peter and John because it was evening, and they put them in the jail till next day. In other words, they put them out of sight from people. So that Peter and John and their teaching would just be forgotten. They didn't want them to carry on with what they were doing. Verses 5 to 7 reminds us of what they wanted to ask. Their question is, what is the power that you have that makes you do this, what you're doing? Friends, these people were, you know, they were quite prominent people. They were presenting this question here. And they wanted to know whether Peter and John will crumble under pressure. So when people ask us questions, how do you do this? Why are you doing this? What do we do? Do we suddenly go into hiding and not sharing anything? Or do we actually say, we do this because we have faith in God? I had the opportunity of actually sharing on Saturday at my daughter's third birthday with a friend who came over. It's one of our neighbors. And we were just having a chat about how he's changed his jobs and things like that. And he said something which is very interesting. And he said, I've got to make sure that my kids are okay and my family's okay. And same for you, you have to make sure that that happens. And I said to him, there's also one other thing that is very crucial for me and my family. And he said, what's that? And I said, it's the faith element. Faith that God will make sure everything's okay. Faith that God is with us. And he shrugged his shoulder and said, okay. But that was an opportunity that God used. And I praise him for that, not know what happened. Things like that will happen in your lives. How are you going to use it? It's the question. This question that they asked, who gives you the authority, Peter and John, was something they wanted to ask to push them away, to make them scared. But they're still strong. These people are upset about two things. Firstly, about the teachings that were happening, that Peter and John had no permission to do that. And secondly, they were upset because they were talking about Jesus being risen from the dead. So how did Peter answer that question? Verses 8 and 10 tells us about it. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them. I think these are very important words for us to see from this passage. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, answered. When we are filled with the Holy Spirit, God will give us the means, the words, and the opportunity to do and share in the best way possible. When we are filled. The key to their response wasn't their intellect. It wasn't their schooling, because as we read, they weren't schooled. They didn't have that. It wasn't because they were powerful in figures in the Jewish entertainment business or in the Jewish business scene or class. None of that. They were fishermen. The most important aspect of why they were able to respond the way that they did was simply because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. These men spoke loudly. These men spoke boldly. They were not ashamed of representing Jesus. And they even reminded these powerful people that they were the ones who crucified Jesus. But God raised him from dead. They were not fearful. They were not ashamed. Friends, we need to stand firm. We shouldn't be afraid. We shouldn't be ashamed of the gospel. When we have an opportunity, we need to stand strong and do what we can do to our best ability. And trust me, God will bless that. God wants to bless it. The foundation of Peter's preaching was the fact that he was filled with the Holy Spirit. And filling with the Holy Spirit only takes place when we are obedient to God, to his word. Verse 11 says, Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which became the cornerstone. Peter here is painting a picture for us and a picture for the Jewish leaders. He again is quoting from the Old Testament and he's applying it to Jesus, quoting from Psalm 118, verse 22. The picture that he's painting is this. The Jewish leaders were supposed to be the builders who are building the eternal house of God. And they were these kinds of stones that they were using in this building of this house. But some stones have a significant placement in the building and some not so significant. And the stone that came from Nazareth is examined by the builders, the Jewish leaders, and they're determined and they said, it's not a good stone. And they throw it out. And they throw it out into this pile, the refuse pile known as Golgotha. and it gets buried in a tomb, that stone. But the architect comes forward here, who's God. Seeing what they've done, they've rejected, they've buried that stone. But the architect picks him up, clears him, raises him from the dead, and establishes this rejected stone as the cornerstone, where the whole entire structure will be established upon. Peter paints this picture of God giving Jesus, the Christ, as the cornerstone that they had rejected. In doing so, Peter puts them in opposition to the will and plan of God. God had provided this Messiah for them. Peter very plainly tells them that you have rejected it. And then we see their reaction. Peter and John were ordinary men. They realized that Peter and John were unschooled, ordinary men, but they were astonished and they took note from these men. They realized that these ordinary men had been with Jesus. Friends, today Jesus wants to be with us. However we feel ourselves, look at ourselves, whether we think we are not important, in his eyes we are. We all are. And he wants to use us. And in different ways, in different circumstances. And that is something that we need to look into. As to how can we use our gifts and talents? Peter and John spend the night in jail because they had healed a lame man from birth. But when they were put on trial, they gave a defense that the accusers were not ready for. They were not expecting that. But once realized, once released, they returned to other believers and they prayed. Friends, we need to be expectant of questions being thrown at us. We will always face accusations as Christians and what we believe in. When I was growing up, we lived in they call this like a compound, basically, where there's several houses going through this gate, and you've got a land owner. And then he's built a few houses that people rent off him. And it's all kind of big, tall walls and barbed wires just to make it safe. And he was in this city of Lucknow, where I grew up, most of my childhood, I grew up there. And our neighbors, they were Hindus. And they were in that compound, they were also Sikhs. But they also knew that we were Christians. So every Christmas, we used to bake cakes as a family, and we used to go and give them cakes. And then also my dad used to give them tracts on the gospel and what it means. Why are we celebrating Christmas and all of that? Once we were invited to one of their daughters, I think it was her first birthday party. Now, if you know anything about the Indian culture, then birthdays are huge. Weddings are bigger. And the amount of people that we get for those weddings are crazy numbers to be looking at. And for the birthdays as well, you're looking at crazy numbers coming in. Anyone and everyone is invited. If people are walking by, they're invited in. And food is there for everyone. Anyways, we were at this big birthday party of this one-year-old girl. And my dad had always said to us, if we are ever offered any food that has been offered to their idols or to their gods, we need to say no. That was always instilled in us. He said, we need to say no to this. And by mistake, if you have taken it without realizing, then you need to pray straight after it, that, you know, God, just cleanse my body. Something that I always kind of struggled with a little bit, but I was still young at that point. So we went to this party, and there was this whole section in the corner where they had their gods all set up, and they all were there. So there was a priest praying throughout the whole party, and there were sweets coming out of it because he was blessing those sweets, and people were getting those sweets. And we all were sat in a row, all five of us, my brother, sister, myself, and my dad and mum. And the skit comes through with this plate full of sweets. Now, as kids, my eyes and our eyes just boom, sweets, well up for that. And we were like, well up for eating it. But the first person they came to was my dad. And he said, no, I'm sorry, it's been offered to your God, so we won't be having it. Something that offended the priest was sat in the corner. And the long and short story of it was that we were kicked out of that party. Basically, they came, said, no, you need to leave. And I was only probably around 10, 11, looking at those sweets while walking out, thinking, oh, I could have had one. But there was something that I realized now as a follower of Jesus, that my dad had to stand up for what he believed in, what he felt God was saying to him, what he felt the word was saying to him. And he had to obey it. And that meant that we were kicked out of that party. I've never forgotten that incident. If anything, it's made me more stronger in where I am at the moment. Because we are going to face that, friends. And life's not going to be rosy if you're following Christ. It's never meant to be. And if you think it is, then probably living in denial. We are going to face those things. Peter and John faced those accusations. They were put in jail because they followed and they were sharing what was on their heart that God had put. We need to be prepared for it. We need to be ready for it. And trust me, when we do what we do, when we do what God has asked us to do, he will give us the strength to get up and leave. And that in many ways was a big, big chance for all those people that sat thinking, okay, these guys believe in something and they stood strong in it. And since that party, they've never, ever offered us any sweets again, which have been offered to their idols, their gods. Something that had to be done in order for the message to be made clear. Something that we need to do sometimes in our lives for the message to be made clear to some people. Are you standing strong in Christ today? Or is he the rejected stone in your life? Christ needs to be that strong, strong pillar in our house, in our church. If he's not going to be that cornerstone that's holding things together, then trust me, friends, we are going to crumble. We're going to fall. Things around us are going to crumble because we are not standing strong in him. We need to stand strong. We need to stand firm. We need to be courageous. Because it's the power of God that will help us through this. Romans chapter 1 verse 16 says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. How can we do it? We need to stand strong, stand firm. We need to find our courage in Christ. We need to be bold in our witness for Christ. And when we face opposition, we need to know that Christ is with us. How we can do it better? Simply by surrendering ourselves to him, to the Spirit of God, and letting him mold and shape us into the people that he wants us to be. Friends, we all have got a testimony. How we share that testimony matters. So if within our congregation, if people don't know each other's story, then we need to share it. If anything, that will encourage us. If anything, that will build us together. If anything, it'll make us closer to one another because we know and see each other's journey, how we walked in. And we'll be able to encourage each other more. Peter and John stood firm and they were courageous because they knew that the Spirit of God was in them and with them. Friends, stand firm, be courageous, because God's Spirit is in you. And he wants to use us. Before I pray, I just want us, I'm going to share this song with us. It's called Cornerstone. And people on Zoom, you'll be able to watch it, but people out here, you'll be able to hear the words. What have you heard this morning? Just remind yourselves of what you heard and ask God to speak to you, to whoever and whatever you've heard and understood.
Lord, Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you that you came and died and rose again on the cross for us. And I pray as we face this week ahead that we will remember this message that we've heard from our pastor today, all that we've learned, and I pray that you will help us apply it to our lives. God, I pray that you keep us safe and healthy until we meet again. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's say the grace to close. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore. Amen.